this evening. Good evening once more.
Good evening.
First of all, some faces are sad, but I'm telling you, I'm very happy because of Jesus. Amen? I'm telling you. You know, listen carefully, friends. You just don't know, you know, we don't know how Jesus actually really is about, all about. You know, we can preach about Jesus, we can sing about Jesus, we can do all that we can do for Jesus, but still we don't know him. I was reading last time a quotation that says, sinners, listen to me, sinners can do much for the Lord. They can preach, they can give all their life to do all that they can do, and still they are stranger to God. Thank you very much. It's already good. Yeah, they are stranger to God. Friend, listen carefully, brothers. That's why the name of Jesus, there is a song that says, sweet name of what? Do you like the name of Jesus? I tell you, I love the name of Jesus. Because would not be Jesus, then I would be in trouble. Now this is 27:25. Minute that we are actually studying. I really praise God that we are here again. I'm telling you, the subject that we are studying, we are going to study this week, is something that we cannot hear this so much in the pulpit. Actually, somehow it's mute the pulpit about this subject. Our theme is the Day of Atonement. Many people don't know, they don't have the clue what is the Day of Atonement is all about. They don't know. But we are Adventists still. But my friend, we gotta understand this. Because we saw it last night, we saw that before the time of trouble will break out, before there will be time of trouble, we must be prepared to stand with Jesus. Did you hear what I said? And we cannot stand with Jesus in the condition that we are right now. Now, we must have a condition. Just look at this. The Bible says, go to Daniel chapter 12. Let's see this. And tonight we're going to take a look a little bit more. What takes for us to stand? Because we need to learn these things. Remember, the last generation, there is something that God must do to the last generation, which he has never done it in the day of Pentecost. There is something that God wants to do which is greater than what happened in the day of Pentecost. There is something that what will happen which is greater, more than what happened in 1844. There will be a great revival and a great awakening among young people, among God's people, that this has never happened since back then. Now, but before this thing happened, must something happen in our life. But remember this, friends. The Bible actually identified, John identified this in Revelation 18. He said that angel which come down from heaven, the angel does not want to get the power. The Bible says he has already the power. And because of the power that he has, that power is the Holy Ghost. Because first, what is this? Acts 1 verse 8, the Bible says, and you shall receive what? Power. When the Holy Ghost shall come upon you. So what made the angel to proclaim that message with the power that the Bible says the whole world was enlightened with this glory? This was because of the what? The presence of the Holy Spirit in him. Now that angel, we know that the prophet said that angel represents the Seventh-day Adventist church. Now the church in the condition that we are right now, brothers and sisters, we cannot receive the Holy Spirit. Something first must happen in us before God gives us the Holy Spirit. And that thing is called revival and reformation. Revival and what? I don't care what the men say. Listen, there are many people who say, oh, let's leave Advent, Seventh-day Adventist, let's go some offshoot. And you know what I mean? Some people, their name? Davidian. I don't know how they called it. And these people, they say, we need to leave. You can go to the internet, you listen to many people say many bad words about the president of even General Office and many other people. I'm telling you, the problem is not just the people. The problem is we left the Bible and we are following men. God says, my word, not the words of men. God says, we gotta hear what I'm saying. Because what gives life is what comes out of the mouth of God. Not what come out from the scholars and whatsoever is the person. You know, we trust more pastors and whosoever it is, but to the word of God we don't trust. Remember we read last night, Jesus Jesus says, how is it, John 5, how is it that you believe everything that men say, but not seek the honor which comes from God only? That's very interesting. I don't know why Jesus used the word only, but I'm going to show you that as we open our Bible. I want to show you this one, then we're going to jump to Revelation. Let's open John 5. John 5. Let's read again. We need to read this over and over again. And please, those who don't have their Bibles, pick up your Bible. Some people don't have their notebooks. There is a notebook there. This notebook was made purposely for everyone who will be here to have a notebook to write down what we are going to study about the Day of Atonement. Now, friend, John chapter 5. Let's read John chapter 5. The Bible says in John chapter 5, and I pray that you may not be distracted. The Bible says the devil, he actually worked so hard when people of God are gathered together like this. John chapter 5. Are you in John chapter 5? John chapter 5. Are you in John chapter 5? Yes or no?
Yes.
Now the Bible says in John chapter 5, verse 41. Father, bless your word as we open it. May your Holy Spirit speak to us. For we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I have received no honor from man. But I know you that you don't have the love of God in you. But God said, love not the world. If any man love the world, that means the love of God is not in. Now Jesus is saying, you don't have the love of God in you. Now let's jump, let's go to verse 46. For have ye believed in Moses, you should what? No, not this one, sorry. Verse 43. I come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not. If any man, whether it's a scholar or a pastor or Adrian, anybody can say anything, Jesus says, if any man will come in his own name, you're going to believe in him. But I came in the name of my Father, you are not accepting me. Now, look at what Jesus says here. Jesus says, verse 44. Now, this is very important. Please, look into your Bible. Verse 44. This is what I want to show you tonight. The Bible says, how can ye believe which receive honor one of another? And seek not the honor that comes from who? The honor that comes from where? From God only. That means, my sisters and brothers, what we should listen is not what men say, or what a pastor say, or what an evangelist say, or what Adrian say, but what we should be listening is what God says. Because what God says is the thing that God wants us to hear. But today, we are people, we are in the generation that we listen to everything that men say, but not what God says. I'm telling you, God had to make a thing to tell us this week. Amen? God had a lot of things to tell us. God had a lot of things to tell us, friend. And we are going to see this. And I want to tell you, please, you are going to be guilty. You will be guilty if you don't invite your friend to come here. Because there are many people out there right now, they are not here. They don't know the subject that we are going to study right now. They don't have the clue. They are talking about something else there. But this that we are going to study this week, my friends, this will prepare us and make us to look like Jesus. Amen? I'm telling you, no one will step to heaven if you don't look like Jesus. And right now, I'm telling you, we don't look like Jesus. Right now, no one here look like Jesus. I'm going to show you what Jesus looks like. You want to know how Jesus looks like? Because we are going to imitate what Jesus looks like. Because that's Jesus is the power, and we need to imitate him. His example. Now go to Revelation, Daniel chapter 12. Daniel says this thing, and the Bible, you know, listen carefully. Jesus used the books of Daniel and Revelation to bring the seven-day Adventist to existence. You know, if you call yourself seven-day Adventist, you should start the book of Daniel and Revelation. And the devil has made us to think these books are too hard to study. I'm telling you, the books are not hard to study. People say, tell me about Jesus, tell me about the love of Jesus, but don't tell me about Daniel and Revelation. My question is, who gave Daniel? Jesus. Who gave Revelation? Jesus. The Bible says this is the revelation of Jesus Christ, which was given to us. Now, in Daniel, there is a prophecy that makes us to come to existence. That prophecy is called Daniel chapter 8, verse 14. He said, unto 2,300 days, then the sanctuary shall be what? Cleansed. From the day that this prophecy was fulfilled, that was the time that the seven-day Adventists came where? Existence. 1844. Now, only if we want a revival and a reformation, that means we gotta go back to the books which Jesus used to bring the church to existence. Now, what do you think that we're gonna bring us life again? Only the thing that gives us life can give us life back. If we throw this book out, no revival, no reformation. Now, notice what the Bible says in Daniel chapter 12. The Bible says in Daniel chapter 12, last night we already saw this, but the Bible says in Daniel chapter 12, right there, let me know by say amen. Now we need to rush, we need to rush. And we have to rush. Remember, we built some foundation last night. We need to continue. The Bible says, verse 1, and at that time, I wish you know, there are people who do not understand the book of Daniel, especially Daniel 11. You know, I'm telling you, I'm being honest, I've heard from many people. Our church has a different understanding of the book of Daniel 11. If you listen to other pastors, for example, Pastor Doug Bass, he's a very good man. He also has a good, he also has a different view about Daniel 11. But my friend, even though all of them, they have different view, but you gotta go there alone and ask God to teach you what you're supposed to understand. Yes or no? Jesus says, the Holy Spirit, not man, he said the Holy Spirit will guide you in how many truth? That means what we need is what? The Holy Spirit. Now this is Daniel chapter 9, chapter 10, chapter 11, chapter 12, all are a continuation of the same subject. You cannot remember these chapters. It's somebody who made this chapter. Before the Bible, there was no chapter, no verse. I was wondering, why this man? I know the man who made this. I mean, I don't know personally, but I start about him. I don't know why he made it, but he made it. But so when you read the Bible, don't just start in the verse, but understand this is a continuation of something. That's why I say, at that time, what time? The time is in the book of Revelation, Daniel chapter 11. He said, at that time shall Michael stand up, the great priest, who is Michael? Tell me. Are we Adventists? Can I say? Are we Adventists or something? But if you're not Adventist, don't be afraid. We can be Adventist tonight. Now the Bible says, Michael shall stand up, the great priest which stand for his children. Now the Bible is continuing, the people, for his people. And there shall be a time of what? Trouble such as what? Never was since there was what? And they shall family, listen carefully. We have seen, if you read the history, I read about World War I and II. You know, I saw killing and death and all these bad things that the man, you know, let me tell you, what actually happened before in this World War I and II, it's not natural. I call it, those people who did all those things and the killing, they was demon possessed. Only a demon possessed can do such a thing. Jesus never can do that. And a man who had Jesus can never do what happened back then. But the Bible says, this was the history says it was a time of trouble. But the Bible says the time of trouble that we are waiting is a time of trouble such as never was before. Now listen carefully. The Bible says in that time, Michael shall stand up. Listen carefully. When Michael sits down, it's all right. You can do what you want. But when Michael stand up, we're in trouble. Now my question is, what takes for us to stand? Anyone know? My question is, because we need to stand with Mike. Go to Revelation chapter 12. Revelation chapter 14. Remember, Revelation chapter 14 is the chapter that the prophet of the Lord, how many of you believe in a prophet? This is a way. Some people don't believe, but, and some people, it's not because they don't believe, some because they don't know who is that. Who is that? Who is that sister wife? Who is that prophet? Who is that? Because no one told them whether she's a prophet. I can prove you from the Bible that she's a prophet. And I can clarify everything to you from the Bible that she's a prophet. Even though right now there are people, even today, 50% of our people no longer believe in the prophet. And 50 believe. But listen, friends. If you don't believe in the prophet, we shall be lost. But the Bible says a prophet can preserve us from spoil. The Bible says that. A prophet's job is to keep the people from spoil. Remember, the dragon was wrath with the woman, which what? Keep the commandment of God as the testimony of Jesus. The testimony of Jesus Christ is the spirit of prophecy. Now, if we deny the spirit of prophecy, which is the gift of Jesus, what, do you think you love Jesus? How can a man say, I love Jesus, but he denied the gift that comes from Jesus? You know, he doesn't love Jesus. The Bible says Revelation, let's read Revelation. Revelation, this chapter will prepare us for the coming of the Lord. Verse 1, Revelation chapter 14, verse 1. The Bible says, and I what? Please read with me. And I what? Please. Remember this, it's not just a preaching, this is a Bible study, and we have to open our Bible and speak out. The Bible says, and I what? Lord. And John says, I behold, I look at a Lord, a lamb. What the lamb is doing? The lamb is stood. Now, it's something like Michael, right? The Almighty is Jesus. They said the lamb, remember this, Jesus is the lamb of God, which take away the sin of the world. He takes away the sin. The job of Jesus will never finish until sin is out of our life. Because that's the purpose of Jesus. It's to take sins. Until he sees sins, he cannot stop taking sin. But this cannot continue forever. There is a limit, brothers and sisters. To Sodom and Gomorrah, there was a limit for sin. To Nineveh, there was a limit. But the thing is, they will repent. To the time of Noah, there was a limit and they repent. To this generation, there is also a limit. And some people say we are going to sin until there is a new theology that people say we are going to sin until Jesus comes. I'm going to show you this week that the Bible says this is not true. Now we got to go believe in the Bible, or men say. We got to believe in the Bible. How many of you agree with Step to Christ, chapter 2? Step to Christ, chapter 2. Step to Christ, chapter 2. It says there that sinners, if they will be brought back to heaven in the way that they are, heaven will be a torture to them. My friend, listen carefully. The new theology is very wrong. A sinner going to heaven, the condition that it is, heaven will be a hell to him. He will desire to go down and to stay here. That's why Jesus says, I must give to my people time to prepare. And we are going to study this week, what is this about? Preparation is all about. Revelation chapter 14, verse 1. The Bible says, and he said, I saw a lamb stood on the mountains Zion. And with him, who is standing with the lamb? 144,000. That means, unless we stand with Jesus, we cannot do what he wants us to do. Because the 144,000, they become like Jesus. The Bible says that. They look like Jesus. They reflect the character of Jesus. And they look how just like Jesus looked. The Bible says, I saw the 144,000 standing with him also. So Jesus stood up. The 144,000 stood up. Now notice what the next part says. And they have the name of the Father where? In their forehead. Name, even in Hebrew language, means character. So it's not because there is any name written here. They just reflecting the character of God. They came to a point that they no longer fall into sin, but they stand with Jesus. I'm going to ask you a question. Can we stand and sin in the same time? Yes or no? Because the Bible says all have sinned and they become what? Sure of the glory of God. My question is, can we stand, can we give glory to God and at the same time sin? Yes or no? Now please, are we intelligent, right? Can we give glory to God and at the same time sin? No. The angel said, fear God and keep, and what? And give glory to him. Now the time to give glory to him, the Bible says the time of judgment. That judgment started in 1844. And we need to understand this because brothers and sisters, we need to understand how then we can stand. Now notice this, the 144,000 is for thee. They don't just have the name of the Father in their head. Verse 3 says that they sang a song that no one can sing. And they were redeemed from where? Yeah. From heaven. Yeah. When you redeem a man from the earth, that man was a sinner. But something happened. He experienced something which brought him to experience of what? A sin. Now, because Jesus must produce a people who are not just, he received sinners, but he must produce people who must become what? A saint. Now, these people, he says, they were redeemed, not in heaven, but on earth. These are what? They which were not defined with a woman. Now, listen carefully. Don't interpret this literally, because woman here represents what? Woman is not woman. You know, when I read this from the first time, I didn't know. Then I say, oh, so that means I will not get married. So that means I will not have anybody. Like, I will think all this. But the Bible is not teaching that. The Bible says, it's not the point. Woman there does not represent literal woman. It represents what? A church. It represents another. It says, they didn't define themselves with the other daughter. False teaching. But they what? They follow what Jesus teach. That's why the Bible says, they did not define themselves with a woman because they are virgins. Just think with me. If these people are virgins, how even call you, can you call a man virgin? There's a specific name for men. Virgin is always for women. Okay? But then virgin, even virgin represents purity. Doesn't represent that the man has no what? That means that's what mean that the man have not married, have not wed a wife, something like that. Now the Bible says, know what the Bible says? Know what the Bible says? That for they follow the Lamb well, wheresoever the what? He goes. Now in their mouth was from no guy. I wish to explain you more this deeply. Friend, listen to this. We must become like 144,000. Because until we learn how to follow the Lamb wherever he goes. Now my question is, where we need to follow the Lamb? Anyone knows? Now we saw last time, we saw this. We saw that the storm is coming. And we saw that that storm is called National Sunday Law. Listen carefully. When by the passing of National Sunday Law, we must come to a point that Jesus must give us his seal, the seal of God. Because that seal represents that if we have the seal, we have come to experience that we start looking like Jesus. We must look like Jesus by then. But then, my friends, if we will not receive the seal of God, then we are going to receive the mark of the beast. The Bible says we need to set our house in order. When you say house, it's your own life first, before even you think about your house and your parents. Your own life, you have to set it in order. Now, the Bible says, because unless we set it in order, we cannot make it. We found out that what this takes for us to get our life in order. What we need to do in order for us to look like Jesus. Because we must look like Jesus. We saw this. We saw that God gave us what? The sanctuary. And in the sanctuary, when we say that the 144,000, they follow the Lamb wherever they go, when the Lamb died on the cross, remember, the altar of one of them represented the cross, because there the Lamb died. That's the place that we do the sacrifice. And when we sacrifice here, that's what was the type of the death of Jesus. Jesus is no longer on the cross. Even though right now many people are thinking as if Jesus is on the cross, Jesus is not on the cross. The plan of redemption starts here on the cross, but it's moving to the most holy place. Now the Bible says there was an any here, we experience here, offerings. And this is the outer court, and there is a holy place where there is a candlestick, showbread, and golden altar. This is a holy place. In the most holy place, there was only one furniture. I will not focus everything, but I have to show you because our title, our theme is the Day of Atonement. A Day of Atonement does not happen here, does not happen here only, but happens especially where? In the most holy place. In that most holy place is the place that Jesus is right now. Since when Jesus went to the most holy place, brothers and sisters? 1844. Now listen to me. That means for us to look like Jesus, we gotta go here. Let me show you this. Listen, Day of Atonement. Now we saw this. Now let's read it. This is says God's purpose in what? In giving the third angel's message to the world. Where? So the purpose why God gave this message, it says, is to what? To prepare a people to do what? To stand how? To stand how? To stand true to him during what? Which is going on even right now. And then it says, this purpose for which we establish what? And maintain what? Father's power. Something for those. Do you know that our school exists because of the third angel message? Everything that we have, this AUP, was established because of this third angel message. The third angel message. That's the purpose. Do you know what I'm saying? And some people say, no, we have to be here because we need to be engineers. Really? My friend, if your purpose is to be engineer, you are going to perish. The purpose is not to produce people who are just a theologian, an engineer, a nurse, but that's it. The purpose is not just that. That thing must lead you to understand this. That thing must push you to understand this. They say, where somebody's father's house, Our school, what else? And what else? And treatment room, what else? We have this here, yes or no? And what else? This is our purpose in carrying forward what? Every line of work in the cup. That's good. That means if this university are not doing this, we are fair. Because the purpose why the school exists, the purpose the food factory exists, is to teach a lesson. Brothers and sisters, we are in trouble because the devil has done something in our church. Listen carefully. The devil right now is not attacking the world. The world is already deceived. The devil is, his objective is to destroy the church called Seventh-day Adventists. Everywhere you go, there are much demons than you can imagine. Anyone who wants to be, to follow Jesus, there are a lot of demons that want to destroy you. Why? Because they know that if you know this, then you are going to wake up the world. Do you know, one man right now, if one man be right with Jesus, he can change the whole world upside down. It was only 12 men. They change the whole world. In this room, there is enough people that can change the world. More than enough, if they understand this message. Now, notice this. Let's move this. I want to show you this. It says, I saw what? I saw that many do not realize what they must be. Now, when you say what they might be, when you say must be, it's something that you have to be. Okay? Not there's a star or some people there you are thinking. But it says they don't realize what they must be in order to live well. In the sight of the Lord without a high priest. And what else? In the sanctuary through the time of war. My friend, there is a time of trouble. And in that time of trouble, we must stand without a mediator. Without a priest. Right now, if you sin, if you commit fornication right now, you see, you have opportunity for God to forgive you. But if Jesus, why do you have that opportunity? Go to 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, let's read this. Because we don't know this. I don't know. Right now, anyone who keep doing whatsoever they are doing, they still have a chance to go to Jesus. There's a reason for that. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, let's read together. 1 John chapter 2. Are you there in 1 John? Let's go along. I say amen. My little children, are you there? My little children, these things I write unto you, that ye do what? Sin not. Now, hey, now when you're English people, when you say period, those people are English people. But there's a difference between a period and comma. When you say period, what does it mean?
Continuation.
Huh?
Just pause.
Pause? Period is a pause? Well, anyone know grammatically, when you say period, what does it mean? Huh? Full one, stop. That's a full stop. So that means many people, that's how they read the verse. They read like this. They read like this. But the Bible says, we gotta go what? Stop what? Sing. Full stop. Stop singing. That's what the Bible says. But many people, when they read this verse, they say like this. And see, they make the verse to look like this. My little children, this thing I write unto you that you may know what? You sin not. But if you sin, that is like this. If you sin, okay, if you sin, repent. But if you don't sin, it's good. That's what the Bible says. The Bible says, stop sinning. And then it says, but if any man sin, we have who? An advocate with the Father. Who is the name of that man? Jesus Christ, the who? Listen carefully, friend. The reason why right now we sin and we can have forgiveness is because there is a high priest in heaven. There is somebody who came to take away our sins, and he must do something with our sin. I'm there. I want to give my sin to Jesus. I have much sin that I have to give to the Lord. And listen to your free brothers and sisters. If your sins will not go to heaven, if Jesus lived the most holy place, you are lost. Because we are going to study that Jesus right now is waiting for our sins because our sins are important. He wants to do something with those sins. And the devil is afraid of that because he knows that if we give our sin to Jesus, the Bible says, if we confess our sins, he's not unfaithful. He's faithful and just to forgive us, not just to forgive, but to do what? To cleanse.
this is for all unrighteous. Remember, this is cleansing mean, if we are going to be cleansed, we are, after cleansing, when you wash a dish, which is dirty, and then you wash it, it becomes clean. How much dirt is in the plate? Tell me. How much? No. So that means the plate came to a point of looking like how? Clean. So that means Jesus wants to bring us to a point that we be something. We be something. My friend, this says, those who receive the seal of God, of the living God, are protected away. Only those people receive the seal of God. Do you want to receive the seal of God? I want to see the hand of the people who want to receive the seal of God. Hands up, okay. Praise God, I say one. Do you know how to receive? There is a condition to receive the seal of God. Do you know how to receive the seal of God? If we want to receive, where is the seal of God? Where is the seal of God? The seal of God is you. Why is no word? Where is the seal of God, friends? Tell me. The seal of God is where? The seal of God is in the law. What happened? The seal of God is in the law, yes or no? The seal of God is the Sabbath. But where is the law? Tell me. Huh? Yes, it's in the Ark of the Covenant. But then, it's in the Ark of the Covenant. But where is the Ark of the Covenant? The Ark of the Covenant is where? In the most holy place. Oh, come on. The Ark of the Covenant is in the most holy place. Now, in the sanctuary, we found something. In the sanctuary, we found what? We found at the outer court, what else? Holy place, what else? There are three parts in the sanctuary. One is the outer court, holy place, and the most holy place. Yes or no? Jesus died in the outer court or in the most holy place? Outer court. What is the outer court of the most holy place in the sanctuary of heaven? Huh? The outer court of the sanctuary in heaven. Remember, there was a sanctuary on earth which is the type of the sanctuary in heaven. The sanctuary in heaven also has outer court, holy place, and most holy place. The outer court of the sanctuary in heaven is the earth. But the holy place and the most holy place is in heaven. That's why Revelation 11 says, when John was asking, God asked him to measure the temple, he said, don't measure the outer court, because the outer court belongs to the Gentile. And my friend, listen again. If you remain in the outer court, no seal. Because the seal of God is not in the outer court, it's not in the holy place, but it's in the most holy place. And we got to go there because Jesus is in the most holy place. What do you think that you're going to look like Jesus when you're in the outer court? Because the 144,000, they followed the Lamb wherever he go. When Jesus went out to court, they went there. When Jesus was in the holy place, went there. When he moved in the most holy place, and they also went to the most holy place. As a result, they look like Jesus. My brothers and sisters, friends, I'm telling you, this is a very serious thing. Is that working? Oh, your laptop doesn't work. Okay. So it's cannot even close. You cannot even close it? Okay, thank you very much. Please, can you put my hand up? Thank you. If it doesn't, it's me to Christ. Thank you. Friends, now, my question is, what takes for us to stand? What takes for us to stand? We need to stand with Jesus, yes or no? My question is, how Jesus look like? Do you know how Jesus look like? Because we must stand. But let's go, first let me show you something in the book of Hosea. Hosea chapter 12. Please quickly open Hosea chapter 12 because our time is also running. At 2:30 we have to finish. Now listen to this, friend. Hosea chapter 12. Let me know by saying amen. Hosea chapter 12. The Bible says in Hosea chapter 12. Hosea chapter 12. Are you there? Hosea, this is the point. You know, we need to believe in the word of God. My friend, it's time for us to believe. Hosea chapter 14. Are you there? Now, notice what the Bible says in Hosea the 14th chapter. It says, verse 1. Oh, what? Please read with me. Allah. Oh, what? Israel. Do what? Return. When you tell them to return, that means they may not go far. He said, return to the Lord thy God. Why? For thou hast fallen by what?
What make a man to fall? Iniquity, sin. So a man, when this sin, cannot stand. But the angel says, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of judgment has come. And what? Worship him when the heaven and earth. Now the time for us to fear, we cannot give glory to God at the same time sin. The Bible says, what make man to fall is because of sin. Now, but we need to stand with Jesus. Now, I wonder how Jesus looked like. Let's read verse 9 of the same chapter. Who is what? Who is what? And what else? Who is what?
Please, try to see yourself. Can you please just comment?
Who is one? The Bible says, who is one? Right? He shall do what? He shall do what? Understand this. He shall understand this thing. Prudent, and he shall what? Know them, for the ways of the Lord are what? Right? And the just shall not fall in them, but shall what? Walk in them. What else? Sorry? But the transgressions are what? What is the next? What is the other word for transgression? Sin. Yes or no? Sin. So I see. Now the Bible says we gotta go look, go to 1 John. 1 John chapter 3. I want to show you something which is too good for us to understand it. Because listen, I'm gonna show you how Jesus looked like. I didn't show you yet, but I'm gonna show you. This is very important, brother and sister. The Bible says in what is this? 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3. Are you there? 1 John chapter 3. Are you there? Let's read together verse 3. The Bible says, every man that is what? Have hope in himself, or hope in him, purify himself, even is his pure. So, is Jesus pure? Yes or no? So, if Jesus is pure, we got to be pure as he is pure. That's why Matthew, the Beatitudes, says, chapter 5, verse 8, he said, blessed is what? The pure in heart. Why? Why? For they shall see God. So if my heart is impure, I cannot see him. Verse 4. Whosoever committed sin transgress also what? The law. For sin is the transgression of the law. Verse 5. And ye know that he was manifest to do what? To take away our sins, and in him there is no what? Sin. Verse 6, please. The first time when I shared this with one of my sisters, he's a friend, he's a theologian. When she was hearing this, she said, no, it's not written in the Bible. I said, it's written in the Bible. If any man commits sin, he doesn't know who Jesus is. I never saw him. Every time when I commit sin, I don't know Jesus. Still, I'm telling my friend, we don't know Jesus. I'm going to show you that we don't know Jesus. And I'm telling you, if we are honest with ourselves and with God, we are going to see that we need Jesus. Notice it. He says, verse 6. Whosoever abide not outside of Jesus, whosoever abide in him, sin what? So the problem is when we sin, we are not abiding in Jesus. Jesus told us, abide, abide. And the reason why we are falling into sin is because we are not in Jesus. When the Bible says, if any man is in Christ, he's a new creature. All things pass away, and everything about the life of that man or woman are near. So when we see a man say, I'm in Christ, but he's still living the same way that he lived when he was in Africa, and he came to the Philippines, in the same way, he's not yet in Christ. If you see a person who was, when he was there in America, who was there, but still now, 2 years, 3 years, 5 months, but still the same way living, do the same kind of things, go to the same place of amusement, that person is not meet Jesus. Because friends, for us to meet Jesus, something must happen in us. A man, when entering in contact with Jesus, the life changed. Now notice what the Bible says. If any man, whosoever abide in him, sinneth not. Whosoever sin, what the Bible says, has not seen him, neither know him. Now verse 7. Little children, that means when we don't know Jesus, and we don't also see him, we can commit sin. But if we see the beauty of Jesus and get attractive, when you see Jesus beautiful, when
when you see the beauty of Jesus, you'll be attracted to him. You say, I don't want any other friend. I want to have only Jesus. I don't know about you, friend. I want to be a friend of Jesus. What about you? I want to be a friend of Jesus. I'm telling you, if we have Jesus as a friend, something must change in our life. Because we can never, you know, when we have a friend, you know, if you have a friend, a best friend, when you have a friend, can you hurt your friend? Can you hurt him? You don't do that, right? Because you know it's going to hurt my friend. I love him. I like him. Now, you want to do everything to please your friend. Now, the reason why we actually, instead of pleasing Jesus, we hurt him. The Bible says when we sin, we crucify Jesus. How? Wow. How you can call your friend like that? Now, Jesus died for us to take our sins. And he also has the power to forgive us. Verse 7 says, little children, let no man deceive you. And what? You know, when John said this, it seemed that, you know, he was seeing the new theologian today. Because there is a people who admit them. You know what they say? They say, we are going to sin until Jesus comes. But the Bible says, God must produce a people who stand in Jesus. And to stand, you cannot sit and stand in the same time. My question is, friend, if we keep the commandment of God, shall we ever fall? No, please, answer me, please. If we keep the commandment of God, shall we ever fall? No, please, you're not even answering, like you're doubting. The thing is, we are afraid because you are saying, oh, what do you mean? I cannot fall? I'm weak. Yes, I'm weak, but Jesus is mighty and powerful. Amen? Now, if we keep the commandment of God, we shall never fall, my brothers and sisters. Verse 8 says, he that committed sin is of the devil. You know, when you see a person say, I'm in Jesus, but he commits sin, and they say, he commits sin, but he's saying, I'm in Jesus. He's a liar. The Bible says, if you're in Jesus, there is no such a thing being Jesus and being sin. The Bible says, any man whosoever commits sin is of the devil, for the devil sins from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. Now my question is, what is the work of the devil? Is that sin the work of the devil? Yes or no? So Jesus came to destroy the work of the devil, to take sins away. The thing is, we are not willing to give our sin to Jesus. As a result, we are in trouble, friends. We are in trouble. Now, brothers and sisters, we don't commit sin. What? We don't commit sin. Verse 9 says, whosoever is born of God, he does not commit sin. For his seed remains in him. The seed is Jesus Christ. When Jesus is in a man and a woman, that man and a woman must change, must be different. Must represent Jesus. There's no such a thing of being of the devil and of the, you know, we cannot be in the middle. We cannot be in the middle. Friends, this is a very serious thing. But notice, my friends, I want Jesus. Do you need Jesus? No, please. I see people, I don't even say, I don't know. I'm telling you, I need Jesus. And there are people who don't, there is a reason why some people don't want Jesus. And I'm going to show you this. Go to 2 Peter chapter 2, chapter 1. 2 Peter, verse 1, Peter. I want to show you this, and I want you to keep this verse in your mind, and then study this, and then pray over the verse, and do the same. Please, I see some people having Bibles. If you have Bible, share your Bible. My sister there, I can God, if you can share your Bible with my sister, please share with them. Share your Bible. We are family. We need to share our Bible so that our friends can also see the same thing. 1 Peter or 2 Peter chapter 1. Let me know by saying amen. The Bible says in verse 3, according to his divine power. Are we together? Now, God has power. Yes or no? You know, many people think God only has power to forgive us. God also has power to cleanse us. God also has power to help us to overcome every sin. There are people who only want Jesus to ask for forgiveness, but they don't want to ask Jesus to give them power to overcome sin, even before they fall into sin. The Bible says, according to his divine power, has given unto us all things pertaining to life and all things pertaining to godliness. Through the knowledge of him that is what? Calling into virtue and what? Glory. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great precious promise that by these ye may be what? Partaker of the divine nature. What else? Have ye escaped the corruption which is in the world through the lust? You know, listen to me. The Bible says, what the Bible says? According to his divine power, are given unto us, by which are given unto us exceedingly great precious promise, that by this promise we must be what? partaker of the divine nature. My question is, what is our nature?
Sinful
nature. But Jesus wants us to have what nature? To partake of. Is the divine, is the nature of God sinful nature? God wants us to have that nature. It's the same thing when we remember when he says that we need to look to be like. You see, he says here. He says, those people, he says, they receive the seal of God, the seal of the living God, and are protected to the time of trouble. They must reflect the image of Jesus. How? Fully. Partake of the divine nature. Now, John verse 10. Verse 10, the Bible says something. I want to show you this. Verse 10, the Bible says, verse 10, wherefore, the rather brethren, give diligence. Don't give careless. Give diligence to make your calling and your election sure. Why we need to do that? For if we do this thing, what the Bible says? Now please, this is too good for you to escape that. For if we do this thing, we shall what? Never fall. Now my question is there any way that we can never fall? Huh? The answer in the verse. The Bible says, if, it says, my brother, it says, that the rather, wherefore, the rather, brother, give diligence to make your calling. That means the first thing that we need to do is to be diligent for our calling, your calling. And your election should, because if we do, not if we preach these things, or if we teach these things, but if we do, you think there is something that we need to do? Do you want to know those things? How many of you want to know the thing that we need to do, that Jesus says we need to do those things, because if we do this thing, we shall never fall? Can I say that? I see some people are afraid, but I'm going to show you this. That some people, they don't believe because of this. They don't believe because of this. If you give me until May 30, I'll be very happy. Let's read this. The young, what happened? Now, everyone here is young, right? This is message to young people. He said what? The young, that's what? Many lessons to learn. Which one is the most important? Which one is the most important? My question, do you know yourself? Because this is one of the ways for us to identify our problem. Now, notice the next. Many see much what? To admire in the life of Christ. But true love for him can never dwell in the heart of what? In the heart of what? Please, you are not reading with me. Read with me. True love for Jesus can never dwell where? Do you know that we can never keep the commandment of God without love? Jesus said, if you love me, you keep. But the reason why we don't want to keep is because we don't love Jesus. It says, but this love can never dwell in the life of self-righteous. So if I do not realize myself, I'm in trouble. It says, not those, what? Not to see. Now please, take a look at this. Not to see our own deformity is not to see the beauty of what? So if I don't realize that I need Jesus, if I don't realize that I need Jesus to help me, I will never see his beauty. If I think I don't need him at all, I will never see his beauty. He says, when we are fully awake to what? Our sinfulness, we shall appreciate Christ. So if I do not see my how I'm so bound, I'll never like Jesus. That's why Jesus said, only those people who are sick will come to me. Those people who think are self-righteous, they will never desire to come. But if you want to follow Jesus, we gotta go into the most holy place. That's what it says here. It says, the more humble our view of ourselves, the more clear we shall see the spotless character of Jesus. Not to see the marked contrast between Christ and ourselves is not to what? To know ourselves. So what is to know ourselves? What is most important? This is the youngest man lesson to learn, but the most important thing is to learn to know what? So if we, what keeps us to know ourselves? When we don't know what? The marked contrast between Christ and what? We are thinking we look like Jesus already. I told you, we don't look like Jesus. We need Jesus, brothers and sisters. until we say, Lord, show me who really am I. I want to understand what I'm doing.
There are many people who are addicted to pornography, addicted to fornication, addicted to pride, addicted to all this kind of sin. This thing that I'm talking about is inside of the church. And this is going on with the high places. When I say high places, it's all the way to the head, down to the last members. And I'm telling you, if we cover ourselves with this is not righteousness. What we need is the righteousness of Jesus. And until we realize this, we are lost, not heaven. We cannot say we are in Jesus when we are living this condition. But my friend, God says, I must send the message that if we go to Jesus, we will understand. Please open your Bible in 1 Peter chapter 1, chapter 2. This is perhaps the last verse that I'm going to show you. First Peter chapter 2. Now I'm going to show you how Jesus looked like. Now, we saw this. We saw why we need to look like Jesus. This is the Laodicea church. And the Bible says, we are saying, this is what we are saying. Why God says, you are poor, miserable, blind, naked, and all the message of the, he says, the message of warning detected by the Holy Spirit are given by the servant of the Lord, the defective of character are presented. But we are saying this. But they say, that does not represent my case. I do not what? Accept the message that you are bringing. I'm doing my best because I'm the president of man. I'm doing my best because I'm the president of anything like that. I'm doing my best because I'm doing many things. I sin and I do all this. I'm doing my best because I go to church. Listen, you can go to church and you still not look like Jesus. To look like Jesus, we gotta go to Jesus. Something massive happened in me that I have to know Jesus as a personal savior. Mary Magdalene, she had 7 demons. Some of us have the demon right now. But we gotta go to Jesus. Jesus can cast out. Some of us, we don't have 7 demons. Some of us have 1 demon. Some of 2, 3, 4. But as more the demons are there, it can increase. But the only one who can set away free from demons is Jesus Christ. He says, this person does not represent me. I'm doing my best. I believe in the truth. Believe in the truth. Demons also believe in the truth. And they fear. Friend, I'm telling you, we gotta go to Jesus. We gotta go to Jesus. Let me show you. This is the subject that we found out that we need to study. And we saw that Jesus on the cross, he just bought. He didn't bring us to perfection, not yet. But Jesus must bring us somewhere which is called most holy place. Because there we are going to look like Jesus. How many of you want to look like Jesus? I want to look like Jesus. But for us to look like Jesus, we gotta go here. I don't have time to explain this, but I will explain to you this next time. I want to show something. I want to jump in. Now let's do this. We found out that there is a great word, and what else? Little time. You think that National Assembly is very soon to pass? We have a great work that needs to happen in our life, in our heart. I see many people want to reach out to others when they themselves need to be reached out. It says, great work and little time. Now what do you say? It says, what is the word? The word is that we must look like God. What is the word again? We must look like God. And the little time is because the time that we are right now, by the part of National Sunday Law, when this pass, we must look like Jesus. And for us to look like Jesus, what we need? 1 Peter chapter 2. Let's read that verse. How Jesus look like? Anyone know how Jesus look like? Look at this. How Jesus look like? Tell me. How Jesus look like? Look at the screen, please. How Jesus look like? How Jesus look like? Anyone knows? How Jesus look like? Anyone knows? Okay, let's read 1 Peter. This is the last verse. We almost end. We're already done. Okay? I know they are pressing me to finish, but I'm telling you. The Bible says, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21. What the Bible says? For even here where? Please do this. My friend, listen, please. Even here, ye are what? Called. Because Christ also suffered for us, leaving what? An example that what? That we should follow what? What this state mean? Tell me the example. Something that we should follow. A parallel. Now, if we need to imitate the parallel, that means we need to see how Jesus looked like. Do you want to know how Jesus looked like? Verse 22. The Bible says how Jesus looked like. The verse 21 explained that we need to follow Jesus. But 22 explained how Jesus looked like. The Bible says, who did not what? No, please, you are not with me, my friend. We start when it was 7:25. It's not even 8:25. So it's not even 40 minutes that I expect. So I'm asking, how Jesus looked like? Who did not what? Who did not sin? What else? Neither God was found in him. Brothers and sisters, listen carefully. Can I sin and I think that I look like Jesus? No. But as long as we are saved right now, Jesus is still calling us, come, because I came to take away the sin of the world. Doesn't matter how much sin we've committed. Doesn't matter how much people we kill, or we've done bad things, and we hurt others, we commit all the kind of sin. Maybe you are the worst sin of the world like me. I'm telling you, whatever sin that you've committed, right now, tonight, there is much time for us to give our sin to Jesus. Jesus looked like this. Do know what? Jesus do not sin. Was Jesus perfect? Yes or no? When Jesus sinless, yes or no? Now remember this, the 144,000, also in their mouth there was no foul word. Guy. So they look like Jesus. So if you want to look like Jesus, now my question is, how we can look like Jesus? The Bible says, if you do this thing, you shall never fall. My question is, what are those things that we need to do? What are those things? You want to know what are those things? Those things are in the most holy place. Now the first thing that I want to show you is, everyone who believes in Christ, this is sign of time. Everyone who believes in Christ. Everyone, doesn't matter what it is. Everyone who what? Rely on the keeping, not in themselves, but rely on the keeping power of a risen one. Say, that is so for the penalty, pronounced where? Upon the transgressors. Everyone who resists temptation. Now, we got to resist temptation. But the Bible says, without me, you can do how much? Can we keep God's law without Jesus? Without Jesus, we cannot keep it. And actually, for us to keep it, it's we need love. Because without love, we cannot keep it. But where we can find that experience that we must love only God and do everything that he said? The Bible says that the way of God is in the sanctuary. That means the way is in the sanctuary. Now, this is said, everyone who resists temptation in the midst of evil, copying the power. You know, this copying the power, the Bible says the same thing that we need to imitate, because Jesus is our example. Copying the power giving way in Christ's life. We through faith, not by sign, but through faith do what? In an atoning sacrifice. This is why I say step to Christ. When it says sin and Christ, sin with the sinless meet Christ, chapter 2. It said you cannot, no, chapter 9. Chapter 9 says you cannot atone for your sin. To atone, atonement means to take sins out and to be one with God. So you cannot have atonement when you are separate. On the day of atonement, we should be one with God, one with Jesus. And what separates us from Jesus, what is the name of that thing? Until sin is out of our life, we are not united with Jesus. We must, for us to be with Jesus, sin must get out of our life. But how sin can get out of our life? By giving it to Jesus, saying, if you confess our sins, he takes our sins. That's why he says here that everyone who by faith keep up through the atoning sacrifice of Christ, be partaker of the divine nature, having escaped what? They will, everyone who copy the power, they will through faith in atoning sacrifice of Jesus Christ, become partaker of the divine nature. Having escaped the corruption which are in the world through lies. Now, the prophet said the same thing, and the Bible said the same thing. Everything that the Bible says, the prophet says. And everything that the prophet says, the Bible also says. Having escaped the corruption and going to last. Everyone who by what? The Bible says, without faith we cannot please who? Hebrews 11 verse 6 says, for without faith we cannot please God. So it says, it will be only by faith that we can keep God's commandment. Only by faith that we can love. I mean, only by love and faith that we can keep the commandment of God. If we don't have these two things, love and faith, we cannot keep it. He said they will reach the condition of sinless in which what?
Adam lived before his transgression. So that means if we keep the commandment of God, if you keep the commandment of God, shall you ever fall? If you're already keeping, are you falling? Yes or no?
No.
If you are keeping, you are keeping, you are not falling. And if you continue keeping, it says we are going to reach what? The condition which Adam lived before they fall. Now this is Bible, brothers and sisters. This is something that we need to understand. And my question is, where we can find that that way that we need to understand? I mean, where we need to find that? The word of God is in the sanctuary.
If you want to keep God's commandment, we gotta go to muscle place. Tomorrow I'm gonna show you. We need to fix. I don't want to disappoint anyone. Tomorrow I'm gonna show you. What does that? Because in to go in the most holy place, to go here, they are conditioned to go there. Are you hearing what I say? Listen carefully. We want to look like Jesus. I want to look like Jesus. What about you? But for us to look like Jesus, we gotta go here. Every other churches, evangelical churches, Presbyterian churches, all what was that? Every church, Baptist church, all the churches that you know, all of them, they are here. Do you know that? Every church in the world, all of them are here in Alpha Court. No one is here. Because they don't know this message. But the Seventh-day Adventists are the only people who know that actually the plan of redemption does not finish on the cross. It's go all the way into the most holy place. And these people must leave the outer court and move and advance into the most holy place. Because if you are in the outer court, I told you, when National Sunday Law passed, no one is going to tell you the National Sunday Law is here. Now tomorrow we are going to pick up here. We are going to see tomorrow that we need to go in here. But to go there, we are going to study what are those conditions. Remember the verse says, if, can you see the condition? If we do this thing, there is something that we need to do. And I'm going to show you that tomorrow night. Remember this, if we get into the most holy place, we are going to look like Jesus. Are you excited to go to the most holy place? Mm-hmm. You want to go to the most holy place? Can we travel tomorrow, go there? Can we see that tomorrow? Are you ready to see that? Please bring your friend. Bring them, and we are going to that most holy place tomorrow night. And we are going to see that the Lord is going to do something. I want to reverently pray with you as we finish tonight. Let's pray. Ask the Lord with a petition. Say, Lord, I want to enter. If the secret is in the most holy place where you are, I want to enter in there. But wherever is my heart that you want to take it, please take it. Let's pray. Father, we want to thank you. For you have given us these messages that we may understand that this is the only thing that will prepare us for the time of trouble. Before we see you, Lord, we are going to experience a trouble. And we have to be in experience that we must look like Jesus. Lord, right now we need Jesus. I plead with your God that may you bless each of the persons who are here present. May you bless your people and help us, Lord, that our desire will be to go into that most holy place because there you are doing atonement for us. You are taking our sins. You are cleansing us completely. We thank you, Lord. Bring us again, Lord, tomorrow. For we ask together with the forgiveness of our sins. Because, Lord, we want to stand with you. In Jesus' name.